Several bills on deck that talk about firearms here in Tennessee and to open up open carry. But for today's show on this handgun special right here on WTNB, Man Up America, we're just going to stick a little bit to form function and kind of hit the high notes.
Cool.
I hope, because we have had several of our listeners after the rifle episode that we had this past fall communicate to us, hey, when are you going to do handguns? I'm considering starting to carry a firearm, going through to get my permit. I want to become more familiar with guns. Where do I start? I always refer those people to several places that they can go. So we'll start today with the FLOP. We're going to talk a little bit about how you approach getting a concealed carry permit here in Tennessee. And then as we get later on, we'll talk a little bit more about the gun. So without any further ado, here comes the FLOP. All right, so here we are in the studio, WTMB. That camera's set really high. You get to see everything up here, right? But on the FLOP today, so how we go about getting a concealed carry permit in Tennessee. Let me say, Mitch, that I started working on this show back in January. And the purpose of working on this show back in January was for us to invite in local folks who work in firearms in the community. I talked to several local gun shops, and not all of your local gun shops are created equal. And I'm going to say this on the air because it's my show and I get to say this. If you want information and education about firearms, consider going to VOW or Posey Guns. Everyone else in town gave us the cold shoulder, and honestly, when I walked in and I started to ask them from a knowledge perspective what they could contribute to the education of the show, I found the individuals at those gun shops, especially the one off the interstate, to be less than knowledgeable when it came to firearms. So what I want you to do for the purpose of this show is if you want information, go to a place that they tend to be very good at giving it.
Yeah.
VOW has an indoor range,
nice.
So you can shoot there. Now, none of these are sponsors of the show. Let me say that.
Right.
None of these people have bought ad time on this show.
But if they want to.
If they want to, we'll take them.
They
but
could.
This is completely for your purposes. If you are new to firearms, if you're old to firearms, you can go wherever you want to go, really, because you know what you're looking
right.
for. You know whether it works
right.
or not. But if you are new to firearms, VOW is great because they've got knowledgeable folks down there, and they've got an indoor range where you can start, and they'll go through the protocol and the etiquette of how you know, shoot a firearm in
right.
the range and all that fun stuff. And then Terry Posey's been at it a long time. I've
mm-hmm.
been no qualms about it, that he's a friend of ours, and he did contribute to our inventory for
yeah.
today, so we would actually be able to show you some of the form and function of those firearms that people often use on this program. So that's our recommendation. As a new firearm owner, if you're looking to get your first gun, you want to know more about firearms, and you're looking to purchase, consider those two locations. They've been very friendly to Man Up America. They've been very friendly to education in this community and to firearm ownership.
Right.
Have you had any experience with those two places, Mitch?
I haven't. I only work with Shooter's Depot in Chattanooga.
That's Chattanooga.
Right?
I'm talking Cleveland.
So I haven't, but... Now that I know that there's an indoor range, then I can.
Yeah, South Lee Highway, mm-hmm. that's VOW, and it's a nice place.
Yeah.
It's a nice place to go on occasion. But at the same token, Terry Posey has quite a good inventory, and he's the one that does a lot of the auctions locally.
Yeah.
I don't particularly recommend that people buy their first gun at an auction, because you never know what you're going to get.
Right.
It is good. You know, a lot of people buy their first firearm from someone they know.
Right.
So when it comes to purchasing a firearm, we went over this in the rifle episode. We'll go over it again here. You want to purchase a firearm, and you walk in to Posey's or to VOW on South Lee Highway. You say, I'd like to purchase a firearm. I don't know what to get. They're going to ask you some very basic questions, which we'll get to later in the program. But when you go into a retailer, they're going to ask you to pass a background check
mm-hmm.
before they allow you to buy that firearm. In the state of Tennessee, if you're to buy that firearm from a private individual, all they have to do is verify residency.
Right.
So a lot of people buy their first firearm from someone they know. The downside to buying your firearm from someone you know is that it may not necessarily be the best firearm for you.
Sure.
It may be the one that's available.
Uh-huh.
So I still encourage you to go into one of those two stores. It gives you a chance to hold a lot of different weapons, and hopefully today's program will give you some information.
Yeah.
Isn't that right, Mitch?
Yeah, that's good. That's
so
good.
What do you see before you?
A lot of nice little ones that fit down in a purse perfect, and then some big obnoxious ones.
And then some big obnoxious ones. Well, again, in the state of Tennessee, they're going to ask you to pass that background check. Mm-hmm. So let's say you've purchased your firearm from VOW or Posey Guns. And you say, I want to carry this firearm in public. In the state of Tennessee, in order to carry this firearm in the in public, you have to have a permit.
Right.
Whether you conceal it or you carry it wide open on your hip like a cowboy with a six shooter.
Isn't that incredible?
Now, in the state of Georgia, North Carolina, Alabama, Virginia, they all have what's called open carry, which means you do not have to have a permit to strap a six-shooter on your hip and walk down the interstate.
Right.
You do not.
Just if you hide it.
Just if you hide it. Mm-hmm. But in Tennessee, it is not a concealed carry permit. It is a carry permit. So, note, when you buy that first firearm and you decide to take it into public, concealed or open carry in the state of Tennessee, you better have your permit.
Now, was there not recently a law passed where you can have them in your vehicle without a permit, or no?
Correct. There was the transport back and forth, and the Supreme Court and a lot of other folks have ruled constantly that your personal vehicle is an extension of your private property.
Cool.
So if your gun is in your vehicle, that you can keep it there. That being said, law enforcement will tell you, if you do not have a carry permit, you should have the ammunition separated from your firearm in your vehicle.
Yeah.
And have it in what's called transport, where
right.
you're transporting the firearm.
Mm-hmm.
That's the mode.
Mm-hmm.
And it's supposed to be that you can't get to the firearm and the ammunition at the same time.
Right.
So they usually tell you put your ammo in the trunk.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't help you for self-defense.
It sure doesn't.
Readily available is what you want for self-defense.
Right.
So I'm going to encourage you, if you think you're going to carry a firearm in public, go through the process of getting your carry permit.
Sure.
Agreed,
sure.
Mitch?
I agree.
Now, you and I both have carry permits.
Right.
So we're always packing.
Always.
Always packing.
Always. So I'll tell you something I was unaware of, though, when I got my carry permit was the kids and I frequently go back and forth to Illinois. Lots of times Drew can't go. So we go. Your carry permit's not valid in
There's
all states,
friends. No reciprocation. No reciprocation.
Yeah.
The closest state without reciprocation is actually Maryland.
Illinois.
Illinois is right next
mm-hmm.
to that.
Mm-hmm.
Depending on where you're coming from.
Yeah.
From here,
yeah.
it's Maryland.
Mm-hmm.
And so know the laws. But
yes.
when you go, again, mm-hmm. if you go to get your carry permit and you go through the class, they're going to give you
yes.
a booklet that tells you what states have what's called reciprocation. In other
yes.
words, they recognize your permit for mm-hmm. carry in that state.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Surrounding okay. states of Tennessee, you're okay.
You're okay.
Going a little further
yeah.
north, usually.
Right.
South, you're okay.
Yeah.
Going further north, you need
north.
To look.
I don't think there were any states south of us that did
not south of us, but part of me says I think we've got an issue with Arkansas.
I believe you're right. I think there were only like seven or eight states.
Very few.
Yeah, so that's good to know.
Now, I said we'd delve a little bit into public policy. There was an instance in the past year where the state of Virginia, the state attorney general, who is a Democrat,
Shocker.
Ruled that the standards for acquiring a permit in the state of Tennessee, well, really all surrounding states to Virginia,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
was subpar to what was required in Virginia, even though Virginia has open carry, right?
Okay.
And that they would no longer recognize permit holders from surrounding states.
Oh.
The governor vetoed
okay.
that pretty much and said, we're going to...
So what's the process like in Virginia?
It's just a little more stringent, I think, with okay. training. But they were really objecting to access to people with mental disorders and things
right.
like that.
Mm-hmm.
That
mm-hmm.
it was hard to make the logical connection. There wasn't any data to back it up. It
sure.
was really an ideological platform. Ultimately, there was enough pressure to where... Senator Bill Carrico, which has been on this program, actually he telephone interviewed early on
mm-hmm.
in this program,
mm-hmm.
was able to convince his governor to veto that legislation, or not that legislation, right. but mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. to keep it mm-hmm. in queue. So you're okay in Virginia now.
Good.
But there was a time where you had to, if you didn't have reciprocation with Virginia, when you got to Virginia, you had to unconceal your firearm. You could still open carry, right?
You can still open carry.
But you had to unconceal it, which right. I don't even know is a word. Mm. Now, Tennessee, at one point, had even threatened to pull their reciprocation and recognition of Virginia's law.
So there's bad blood there.
Which would have been worse for Virginians coming into Tennessee sure. because they would, since we have a carry permit, have to unload their firearm at the state line, mm-hmm. separate the ammo mm-hmm. from the firearm in order to bring it into the state.
Right.
Even if they had a Virginia carry permit.
Right. Right. Well, you know, that's what they say to do.
All that to say is if you're carrying a firearm, know whose yard you're playing in.
Right.
Okay. In the state of Tennessee.
Right. But the good thing is that, you know, the class that you take is very good about giving you information about what you mm-hmm. can and cannot do. And so definitely find a good class and take it.
Now, some of our listeners and viewers right now are saying, you keep speaking of this class. Where do I take right. this class? You can take it through a private vendor. Like a VOW, or I believe Fugits up uh-huh. in Charleston, mm-hmm. Offers a class. You're going to pay more for that class, usually about $50.
Right.
It usually is a one-day long class on Saturday, and then you do your shooting test right after the class right. or the next day. Mm-hmm. The cheapest way to take the class is through a local sheriff's department.
But you got a really long wait for
those. There is, because it only costs $5 mm-hmm. for a range fee mm-hmm. to get your class done.
Yeah.
Eric Watson, Sheriff Steve Ross in Polk County, all of those folks offer handgun training.
Right.
City of Benton does it through mm-hmm. Rocky King.
Which is great.
Absolutely.
That is great. If you can think that far in advance to get your mm-hmm. name on the wait list, that's a great
And
option.
I did mine with the sheriff's department. In mm-hmm. fact, former Sheriff Jim Ruth was my shooting coach
well,
at
there
the
you
time.
Go.
Sheriff Tim Gobble
Fancy pants.
Was the individual who was in office. But very informative class. I'm trying to think. Oh, Richard was in there, and he did this demonstration. He actually works for I believe it's Tennessee Emergency Management,
okay.
TEMA.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
He came in and he pulled like 18 guns off of his body
off
that
his
you
person.
Wouldn't know he had
yeah.
when he first
yeah.
got in there. In other words, showing how you can conceal a
right.
weapon.
Right, right. I took mine down at Shooters Depot, and actually, funny story, the reason I chose there was because they had a Groupon.
A Groupon, there
a
you
Groupon.
Go.
I believe it was a buy one, get one. So a friend and I went and took it, and it, you know, it took an afternoon. We dropped the kids off at school, went and took the class, done, out of there, good to go. So it doesn't take long. They're good, and, you know, it's good information.
So that's kind of what I would recommend to the newcomers. So on the flop, we wanted to go through that. If you're interested and carrying a concealed weapon in Tennessee, if you feel a need for personal safety, or if you're just I want to exercise my rights, therefore I would not lose them
right.
kind of person, okay?
Right.
If you're one of those people that says, we have a right to bear arms, Second Amendment, and I feel like I need to exercise that right to
sure.
appreciate it, go to one of those two locations, Posey or VOW. They'll be glad to answer your questions,
yeah.
let you hold a firearm. They'll advise you accordingly. Find one that you are comfortable with,
mm-hmm.
and then
yeah.
go to a range or somewhere. If you go to an indoor range like VOW, they're going to give you some insight and learn to shoot that.
Right.
You do not have to have fired a gun before to go through the personal carry class.
No.
Part of what they do is a bit of training and
sure.
understanding, and they'll help you along. The people who teach
sure.
those classes are wonderful people
yeah.
who are going to make you more comfortable with your firearm. So if you're wanting to carry one, go see those people, find a gun you're comfortable with, and then go to the class.
Right. But don't let it stop there.
Don't let it stop there because when you file for your permit, it's going to cost you $115 to get your carry permit
yes.
in the state of Tennessee. If I'm not mistaken, and I haven't tried exercise this yet, but I'm planning on it, I believe they've passed a lifetime carry permit in Tennessee now. I think
know.
Senator Mike Bell supported that. I'll double check. I knew it was up for discussion.
Yeah.
I believe they passed it,
huh.
which would allow you to pay a one-time larger fee and not have to renew
so
it.
So like a lifetime hunting license for
kind
little
of.
Ones. And,
kind
mm-hmm,
of.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Cool.
The next step for a firearm is to spend time with it.
Exactly.
And there are a lot of people who fear firearms, who do not like them, do not mm-hmm. like what they do. And my first question is, do you shoot guns?
Right.
And if they say no, here's the analogy I tend to give. If you've ever driven a car, all right, and if you're of age to where you can get a handgun carry permit, you've driven a car, hopefully.
Oh,
okay.
Right.
There was a time when if you sat down behind the wheel of that car, there was a lot of fear and anxiety.
Sure. Yeah.
Because it's a big, dangerous thing,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
The more time you drive, the more comfortable you
yes.
become with that car.
Absolutely.
Can you still be reckless
yes.
and become too comfortable with
mm-hmm.
a car?
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Uh-huh.
Can that car injure and kill you? Absolutely. But the more time you spend behind the wheel, the more your fear dissipates.
Very true. Very true.
And we've got Mr. Producer walking in with an envelope. What is this here?
Lifetime
handgun. Okay. Oh, so it is true. There we go. Lifetime carry permit. Read it for us, Mitch.
How to apply for a lifetime handgun permit effective January 1, 2017.
See, I thought it was. Yeah.
Yes,
okay,
very
go.
Good. So complete and sign a handgun permit application at the Driver's License Service Center. Submit the application fee of $200. Have a
wow.
new photo taken.
Thank you, Mike Bell.
Incomplete applications cannot be processed. Fees are non-refundable, and please allow 90 days for processing.
There you go.
So,
handgun carry permit,
$200.
Lifetime,
that's
$200. By
you.
Comparison, your, what is it, six-year renewal on a regular one? $115
yeah.
every six
yeah.
years.
So you're good to go.
So when I come mm-hmm. up for renewal, lifetime.
Yeah.
$200.
Done.
Gonna happen. Thank you, Mr. Producer Josh.
I would almost
give Josh a big hand.
I would almost do mine.
Josh's gun's on the table today.
He does.
We should play a game. Whose gun's whose, right?
I know. Oh my gosh.
Let's see if we got any. If you're on the socials, see if you can find out who whose gun is whose. See if you can guess.
Whose gun belongs to whom? That is incredible. I know. I think as a woman, there's nothing more infuriating than walking into a place that sells firearms and telling them that you want to purchase a new weapon, and they immediately steer you towards the pink ones. And I'm like, what about
What's
me?
What's wrong with the pink ones?
What about me says to you that I would want a pink one other than the fact that I am a woman? No, I don't want your pink gun.
Well, you're not only a woman. You are a prepared woman.
I'm a prepared
right?
woman. That's
Which,
right.
My wife's a prepared woman,
yes.
too, and we like those things.
And what does Rachel carry?
Rachel, hers is on the table. Maybe we'll let
okay.
people guess.
Oh, my
Rachel's
goodness.
Rachel's firearm is on that table. Maybe we'll let you guess. Okay, we've got a couple of comments here. All right, somebody says you can carry loaded in your vehicle. It's no longer illegal. That's true.
Okay.
Thank you for the clarification.
Very good.
I was getting up to the Virginia thing
right.
where
right,
if
right,
you
right,
came
right.
into Tennessee, you've got to separate from that. But, yeah, it allows you – that this debate came up in Tennessee a few years ago, and the governor actually did not support it, in which people driving to work in places of employment were saying you cannot have a firearm in your car.
Right.
What I want people to take away from this program is it's time and time again the courts have said your personal vehicle is your private property.
Right.
It's your
right.
private property. You can have it in there.
Well.
Even then, if you get – you get pulled over with an officer,
mm-hmm.
they might, and you're in North Carolina or someplace mm-hmm. else like that, people can still give you trouble.
Right.
So just get your carry permit.
Right.
That way you're legit. You've
right.
got a reason. Get your carry
Are
permit.
Are you that one that is forthcoming with the gun permit right away when you get pulled over? Or
I'll say this.
Do you always?
I understand where people say, I don't have to tell an officer anything.
Right.
There are people who say, I do not have to tell an officer my name. I don't create trouble for
yeah.
trouble's sake. I have
yeah.
a deep respect for the job they're mm-hmm. trying to execute. So part of what I try to do if I get pulled over or I have to encounter law enforcement is I want them to be comfortable with
sure.
me.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
I don't want to position myself as trouble.
Right.
Even though I may have a right to say, I'm not telling you anything.
Yeah. Incomplete
now, I'm sure
truth
there comes a point where
news.
I'm like, listen, buddy, we're done talking.
Right.
Okay. But no, he walks up to my window. It's usually a kind exchange. Sir, how you doing today? You know,
so
and
you
I get pulled over.
So
because
you get
here, I get away
over
with nothing.
Often, right?
I get away with nothing. Just so you know, I get away with nothing. If I am 5 miles an hour over the speed limit, there will be a police officer around the corner. It happens.
Mm-hmm.
If I get pulled over, the first thing I say is, yes, sir, I have my firearm Would you like to see it?
Mm-hmm.
I have never had an officer say, yes, I would like to see your firearm.
Mm-hmm.
I get the same response every time. Thank you for letting me know. Do you? And occasionally they'll say, do you have a permit for that?
Yeah.
And I'll say yes. No one's ever asked me for my permit.
Well, there you go.
Now, then again, I am a Caucasian male.
Right.
And mm-hmm. I can't tell you if I was a different color, if that'd be any different.
Right.
But what I can tell you is I do have friends who are not Caucasian males who report the same kind of feedback.
That's good.
I think that it builds rapport mm-hmm. up front mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. with the officer to say, listen, I don't want to hide anything. I do have a firearm. It's in here. I'm allowed to carry it. They look at that 9 times out of 10. And if you're – I know we've got law enforcement that listen to this show – echo that sentiment. I think all the ones I know would say that.
Sure.
Is, yeah, it lets me know, okay, you're here to work with me. This
right.
isn't going to be a controversial exchange.
Right.
You're here to comply. Yeah. We'll get through this.
I completely agree. That's the general. I have only been pulled over one time where I have needed to say that. And then that's been the same thing. Here's mm-hmm. my carry permit. There is a weapon in the vehicle. Do you want to see it? No.
Now, there is a caveat. There are some things that exclude you from buying a firearm or carrying a firearm, even though you may not have to have a carry permit to carry it in your vehicle in Tennessee
right.
any longer. You better not be a convicted felon.
It's bad news.
Or under an order of protection or a restraining order out of
yeah.
a court there,
yeah.
or have a mental issue that precludes you from being able to
right.
Own a firearm. Make sure that you have the legal ability
mm-hmm.
to carry a firearm, mm-hmm. and everybody's individual on that level. So that's all we've got on the flop today. When we come back, we're going to talk a little bit about form and function, and we're going to talk about effectiveness in firearms. Again, you're listening to Talk 101.3 The Buzz, WTNV Television, right here in Cleveland, Tennessee. This is Man Up America, our handgun special. Episode number 2 in the firearm series, and we'll be back in a moment.
Things every minute of every day to protect them. Don't stop now. Woodman Life Family Term Life Insurance covers your entire family with a monthly premium that won't increase for the first 20 years, guaranteed. Things every minute of every day to protect them. Don't stop now. Woodman Life Family Term Life Insurance covers your entire family with a monthly premium that won't increase for the first 20 years, guaranteed.
The good Dr. Jay Adam here, talking to all the gentlemen out there. For those of you with wives, girlfriends, even mothers, which would make all of you, you need to call 423-472-8887 and talk to the good folks at Bliss Day Spa. Nothing says I love you like the special treatment, the VIP treatment of the services of Bliss Day Spa. Call them today, 423-472-8887. Tell them the
Jay Adam, have you ever felt kicked in the gut when trying to get approved for a loan or a home mortgage? Then go by and see my friends at Home Mortgage Solutions for a free approval. They don't hand them out like candy and just tell you what you want to hear, but they dig deep to find the solutions you need to get qualified. They have competitive rates, and with over 80 years of experience under one roof, you don't have to go anywhere else. They're never too busy, so just give them a call, 423-339-8086, or visit HomeMortgageSolutionsLLC.com.
It's reassuring to know that when you retire, Woodman Life will be there with you. providing insurance protection and financial security so that you can sit back, relax, and enjoy your retirement, knowing that you and your family are safe and secure. For more information,
423-790-2847.
Woodman Life, standing strong for generations.
Okay, folks, nothing too elaborate with this commercial right here. The venue Creekside is located in Cleveland, Tennessee, and is here for your next event. Most people rent a facility, and then they spend hundreds, if not thousands, of dollars bringing in the things they need to make it an awesome event. The venue Creekside has it all on site. It's included tables, chairs, linens, everything you need in multimedia, from sound, lights, and video. It's all right there. Consider it for your next corporate meeting, right there at the Venue Creekside, located at the Village Green. So get more information at thevenuecreekside.com or call them 473-9668. If you mention Man Up America, save an extra $100 on your rental.
Welcome to Nissan of Cleveland. Stop by our showroom today to take a look at the amazing vehicles we have for sale, like the brand new Nissan Maxima and the V8 Titan. Check out our Imagination Bar where you can view our entire inventory in real time. Also, our dedicated service specialists are here to ensure your vehicle is repaired and on the road in no time. Here at Nissan of Cleveland, our Sonic pricing ensures that you receive a fair, competitive price on your new vehicle, and we back that with a lifetime warranty. Nissan of Cleveland, located just off exit 20 on I-75.
Back here at Man Up America. Handgun special today. We've already talked a little bit about, if you're interested in carrying a concealed weapon or an open carry or a handgun or whatnot, some steps to take and do. Right. Again, our good friends at Posey Guns down off Keith Street, right next to the Crystal right there in Townhouse Bakery, have supplied us with some firearms today that we can look at. And we've peppered in some that we own.
Yeah.
So this is kind of cool.
Has anybody made any guesses? Slightly disappointed.
Not on social media right now. I don't think they can see them too well. Somebody did text me and said I really can't see them. So we'll figure out how to introduce that as we go along. What we have here on the blanket is really a smorgasbord.
Right, a menagerie.
There are a lot more firearms. What you'll notice if you've never owned a firearm or carried one, and why I'm sending you into a store with a bunch of them to hold, is there's a lot to choose from. And I think comfort in your hand is a big thing.
Absolutely.
So you'll find them really, really small. It doesn't necessarily mean you need to carry a small firearm. Yeah. If it's not comfortable in your hand, when you go to shoot it and practice at the range, you're never truly going to be comfortable with it. Likewise, you may want a big kick butt gun, like the 44 on the table. You may want that, but that's not going to be realistic for you to try to carry around.
No. I made the comment earlier that I have giant man hands. So
Those man hands there, Donald.
I got bear paws. Okay. These hands were made
for beating
kids' booties.
We're going to get a size reference of Donald Trump's hands and yours, and we're going to compare them on a future show.
You could do like Michael Jordan's hand, you know, where he's palming the ball, and I could, but I need man a bigger
hands.
Grip.
Man hands. So. I notice you don't. You're not a. You're like a only paint one thumbnail person. No. Is that right?
Bugs lovingly paint.
Okay, that
nails.
One or the other. So, I thought yeah. there's this thing now about code. Like you're sending somebody a message.
Lots of dirt underneath those fingernails. You know, no jewelry because I've.
Well, you work a farm.
Right.
You
right,
work a farm.
So, you know.
So your gun is on this table.
It is.
And we'll start with that. Just. Go ahead and pick
can
up
I
your firearm
pick it
there.
Up and show it this way without pointing it. Anybody can,
okay,
can you
let's
see
get
it?
Okay, here we go.
Can you see it now?
Oh, we lost the close-up cam. Oh. Really, we lost the close-up cam. No power,
this,
Mr. Producer.
From this angle?
See it from that angle.
Okay,
I wish we had the close-up cam. We lost it. I'm sure we can get our producer back in here to fix it.
Yes.
So, yeah, this is a Taurus
right?
a Millennium.
Mm-hmm.
It is not the hammerless.
No.
They make a hammerless. Mm-hmm. That one actually has a hammer. Mm-hmm. Why did you choose the hammer? And for people who aren't familiar with firearms, point to the hammer for me there, Midge.
Right here.
Okay, the hammer's essentially the back part.
Right.
Some people call the hammer the trigger. The hammer is not the trigger.
No.
But it's part of the,
again,
you know,
go find yourself a
it's
class
part of firing
to take.
It. Part of firing. But why did you choose a hammer? Did you not really care?
I didn't have a preference on it. I went solely on... It felt really good in my hand.
Oh, the close-up's back.
Okay, there. Can you
see that's real close.
Is that good?
There you go.
There you go. Okay, just trying to hold
explain
it
the bear.
Not...
That's a state symbol on your shirt, isn't it?
Yeah, California.
California. All right. This is ironic. We're doing a handgun special while Mitch wears a California shirt.
Right.
Okay, so
no,
why did you choose this firearm?
I went because it felt really good in my hand. It had a really good fit. It's light. Mm-hmm.
But it's still large in terms of personal carry.
Very large for personal carry.
Most females prefer something a bit smaller.
Right.
But they don't have man hands.
They don't have man hands. I'm more comfortable with a larger gun than a smaller gun. Just because also with carrying it with my kids in the car, I didn't ever want them to think that it was something they could pick up. And okay. I feel like the smaller the gun is, the more likely little hands are... to get a hold of it.
Well,
just a preference.
And speaking of little hands, now I will say, for those of you who aren't familiar with handguns, for young children, if you don't carry one in the chamber, in other words, you don't actually, if it's all in the clip and not one in the chamber, it is somewhat difficult
for
a small child to rack the first round.
Right.
But your gun also has a safety on it.
It does have a safety.
So show them where that safety is on your firearm.
Safety's here. So you can push, or up here, I guess.
Yeah, I was ready to say, you're pushing the clip release.
So it's here.
You're pushing the clip release.
And I feel like it's pretty easy to push down.
Okay.
So Bugs, my 9-year-old, could definitely
but it'll help
flip
with
this down.
Accidental discharge
but
in the purse.
They did go through a gun safety class. They got BB guns, and we made them treat it just
very
like it
good.
Was a real gun. We took them to the class, so they learned everything they needed to know about handling their guns and not necessarily guns like these, but they understand that this is not something you should ever touch.
Very good.
Mm-hmm.
Very nice. With our children, I kind of use my introduction as they get older into firearms. My oldest son at the age of 12 is now shooting a .22 rifle.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
He has not taken a shot with a larger rifle yet. He will as part of his rite of passage at 13 when he can take the shot hunting. But he is shooting a .22 now. I start them early on, and believe it or not, I test my children with unloaded firearms because we teach them if they see a gun, whether it looks real or not, that they're supposed to immediately tell an adult there's a gun. So they'll tell you, if you see a gun, what do? Don't touch it, tell an adult.
Right.
Because you never know if one could be sitting around.
Lots of Nerf guns
look just like this one.
Look
just like that one. And we'll get to the orange one here in a minute, or even just like the Tiffany blue or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
So we teach our children pretty clearly early on to recognize if you see a gun, to tell an adult, don't touch it.
Sure.
And I test them.
Yeah.
Occasionally, yes, people, viewers, listeners, occasionally I will test my children and I will leave an unloaded firearm out to see how they react to that gun. And people go, oh, you leave a gun around? You know, I'm watching. You know, they're in the periphery. But we do test them. I test them. So your firearm has a safety.
Right.
Hold your firearm up again because this is a good thing. Before we get into actual different models, I want to show you something about Tiffany's gun here. Tiffany's gun, actually, it does have a hammer. Point to that hammer again.
Okay.
This is important because if you're going to carry in your purse, that hammer can get caught on things and pulled back. And but once it's pulled back, you still have to pull the trigger for that hammer to release and fire the firing pin. It does have a safety on it, which is you've looked at it one of two ways, right? Mm-hmm. There. Mm-hmm. It it can keep it from accidentally discharging in your purse, but it can also be one more thing you have to remind yourself to do in a quick situation to, you know, discharge that firearm. Mm-hmm. Her gun's a little larger. Go ahead and put it in your hand so they can see how your hand fits around the base.
I don't have the clip in it, but...
Doesn't have the clip. Do you keep a pinky extension on your clip?
I do.
Okay, I keep one on my clip. Or my magazine. Excuse me, we're going to get reamed by the handgun people. Yeah. It is a magazine. It's not a clip, but it is colloquial in the South to refer to it as a clip. Right. I understand it's not technical.
Can you see?
See, there you go. The pinky extension, point to that. And that just allows for more comfort.
It is. It's just more comfortable.
I like to have my pinky on. I like a pinky extension on my firearm.
Yeah.
So there is her. So those are some pieces to that that firearm.
Right.
What caliber is your gun?
It's a 9mm.
A 9mm, which is the most popular round. Mm-hmm. A 9mm is usually the threshold round most personal carry people will tell you to carry because it allows for decent knockdown power.
Right.
It is a slow-moving round, about 985 square feet per second or something like that. Square feet. Or 985 feet per second, square feet. It goes in a square. Cubic feet. It just spins like a tornado.
Right. You know, something interesting that I was taught in my carry class was when you keep your clips loaded,
magazine. We don't
loaded,
want to keep getting the hate.
You wear down the spring.
Okay.
And so you'll have a higher rate of misfire if that spring is worn
down. So unload it every night.
So not unload it every night, but what they encouraged us to do was just to keep a minimal amount of bullets in there, not keep it fully loaded so that spring
is strongly disagree, and for two reasons.
I keep six in there because that seems like a good number to me in case I ever need it.
It's like the Doc Holliday approach. I got two bullets, one for the each of you.
Right.
You're seeing double. That's the greatest scene. Speaking of great movie scenes, everybody remembers the old lady in Police Academy.
Yes.
We have that gun here.
Yes.
Not quite as long a barrel, but we don't want you walking around having that happen either.
Right.
Hold up your magazine there. I don't know if I agree with the minimal number. I would just rather buy a new magazine every now and then to affect that. I think if there comes an instance, and my wife, I encourage her to do this, and I believe in this, and this was taught to me by law enforcement, if it comes to where you have to fire that weapon, leave all the bullets out of the weapon.
Yes.
In other words, I want to have a maximum amount of rounds in there, and if I'm ever prompted to have to use that firearm to protect myself, it is ill-advised to take a shot and assess.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
Most people will tell you unload that magazine. Fire, 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 fire.
Because you don't want it to be turned around and used on you.
Correct. So. And you're more likely to stop what the impending threat that you felt you needed to stop, which encourages the severity of if you were to ever have to use a firearm, the severity of it.
Sure.
The first question I have for those of you who do not own a firearm is before you choose to carry one, ask yourself, could you shoot someone?
Right.
Because if the answer is no, I don't think I ever could, there's no reason for you to carry this firearm because ultimately, if you're in a situation where you're threatened, you're only producing a weapon for someone else. Okay? Because you're
enough.
Not willing to use it,
fair
right?
Enough. Fair
and you're
enough.
Not going to pistol whip anybody. Sorry, you're not going to pistol whip anybody.
No.
So your magazine up again. Yours is actually a double stack magazine.
Yeah.
For those who, there's a single stack and double stack. All that means is it actually is a bit wider to where the bullets can fit closer to one another and you can get more rounds in a firearm.
13.
The downside to that is it makes for a thicker weapon, which is harder to conceal, especially in your waistline.
Yeah. Yeah.
So there's kind of some function.
They do
of the guys.
Make now for women out there. There's a line of yoga pants that have a nice conceal pocket on them. So there you go.
Next up, reach for the orange gun there. That is also a 9mm. The reason I brought this firearm is this is actually serves two purposes. One, it shows that firearms can look like toys.
Right.
So the emphasis on gun safety if you have children. I don't necessarily recommend having a Tennessee T orange weapon in the house when you've got a lot of young children.
Right.
But this is a Sky 9mm. Mm-hmm. This is a newer brand. They only make this weapon. They only make a 9mm handgun, this company does, mm-hmm. but it's reasonably affordable. You can get into this firearm for about $260. Posey tends to have a lot of them a lot of the times. So if you don't want to take a huge leap into an expensive firearm, I might tell you to consider right. this one.
It's a really light gun.
It is light gun. Mm-hmm. It's double stack, so it mm-hmm. carries a decent amount of rounds.
No
it's
hammer.
Very comfortable to hold.
Mm-hmm.
I find
honestly not this awkward holding a handgun. I'm just trying not
yeah,
to
you're
point
trying
it
not
at
to point
anyone.
It at anyone. But this is a very comfortable gun. I have shot one of these. I did find it to be a very nice gun for a 9mm. And so this is probably a model I'd consider or tell you to consider go holding and see if it's comfortable.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I think what they've done with the grip's very, very comfortable. It's not as balanced as a lot of other
right,
firearms, so when you shoot it, it's going to be a little
mm-hmm.
top heavy.
Mm-hmm.
But when it's loaded with the double stack, it levels out a little bit. So once again, just so you can see the Sky. Another thing that you'll notice about that weapon is it does not have a safety.
Right.
Does not have a safety. That button on the side is actually the slide release up there.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It does not have a safety, so keep that in mind as you're looking at a weapon like that. But it is very comfortable. And if you'll hold it up next to yours there, Mitch, they'll be able to see it's a slight bit smaller. Turn that upside down there to where you can slide, face the slides toward the camera. There you go.
Yep.
So you can see it's a bit smaller, and both of those shoot the same round, 9
right.
millimeter.
Right.
Again, pinky extension on that magazine.
Important for man hands.
Absolutely. Now, but in the realm of personal carry, those are both considered larger firearms for mm-hmm. personal carry. And I want to get kind of into the gender difference on the river, which is coming up shortly. But as we move kind of down the map here, we'll get into some other styles of weapons. The two guns that you've looked at is kind of are modern style, semi-automatic
right.
weapons. Not all of those are, not all of the guns that you carry are that particular style. If you don't mind, Mitch, down at the very end down there, there is a Colt, and this is a 1911 style.
Ooh,
and as you can see,
heavy.
It's still a semi-automatic. It has obviously a hammer, so it's
right.
not hammerless. If you'll hold that Sky back up next to it, you'll see that the Sky does not have a hammer on the back, so it's considered a hammerless, so you can't
right.
pull that hammer back. Why hammer? A lot of times a hammer will allow you to utilize what's called single or double action.
Right.
We don't have time to go to that on the show, but you can Google that and it'll explain. In other words, that has to do with how light of a trigger pull you want. You can have a stiffer trigger pull if you leave the hammer up. If you actually cock the hammer back, your trigger pull is going to be lighter
right.
and easier to discharge the weapon. So a lot of people who find trouble with a stiff trigger, females,
right.
smaller females, older females,
right.
with a stiff trigger may choose a hammered weapon so they can use their thumb
right.
to pull the hammer back to engage a lighter trigger
sure.
pull.
Less jerking when you pull.
So that's a 1911 model. Hold that up compared to your firearm there and just kind of walk it around. If you'll see, both of them have a top slide that slides back, but
yep.
if you'll look at the ejection chamber, just turn them up. Turn them up like this. Top side. Show the tops of the firearms
well,
in the camera. There you go.
I can't really.
You're being very
no.
careful. Safety third.
Safety third. Sorry,
okay.
Josh.
tilt them forward just a little bit there. There you go.
See them there.
You'll see the 1911 ejects out the side
right.
and that off the top. What sure. I'll say about
how's
the
this?
Difference between...
Is that better?
Yeah. What I'll say, the difference with the 1911, it is a harder firearm to clean, but a very reliable system of fire. The Colt's really popular
it's
in that.
Very heavy.
Sig, Kimber, those kind of places. But it is a heavy firearm. It's
yes.
all metal.
Yes.
It is all metal.
It does say government model.
That's
the
that. There
that,
you go.
So.
Once again, a very large firearm for personal carry. People mm-hmm. tend to wear those on their hip. Occasionally, you'll see a cowboy wanting to hide that inside his pants.
Don't call
but
your Wranglers
not,
are too
not
small
always.
For that.
Not always. The other style that we can look at, if you'll grab the 38 Special right there, Mitch, that is a revolver. And when it comes to a revolver, you'll notice that just this is the old cowboy gun kind of approach, right?
Mm-hmm.
You load the chamber.
Right.
You know how to release the chamber on that gun right there. It's right there at your thumb trigger low. There you go.
Am I pulling down or up on it?
You push forward.
I'm pushing.
You're pushing. There we go. There you go. Okay. So you can show people. There you go. Notice how Mitch pointed that to the ground. Thank you, Mitch. Not into the air like a previous law enforcement officer. That fired one in the Justice Center. but you see right there, this is a revolver. It holds 5 shots. It is a 38 special. 38 special to our viewers is slightly larger than 9mm, but not much. And
this
are
is
we
a
going
pretty
here?
Popular gun. Here?
That's a 38 special round right there. It is a very popular gun for this reason. That is a point-and-shoot gun.
Right.
If you're not familiar with a point-and-shoot gun, you point it, you pull the trigger, it's going to fire.
Right.
It does have a hammer to where if you want to lighten that trigger pull mm-hmm. by cocking that thing back. Mm-hmm. And this is one of those to where, like I struggle. My grandmother for home defense. If it's too complicated to shoot, she's not going to shoot it.
Right.
Now, my grandmother's the kind of lady that never would shoot anyone, so she doesn't have one. But for females like it a lot. It also does not eject a cartridge.
Right.
So if you're one of those people, and believe it or not, females, I'm just going to warn you, if you're be careful of hot cartridges
hot.
In
mm-hmm.
low-cut shirts,
right.
okay? Where you go to the gun range, wear a shirt that where it can't fall down in there because we've seen that happen time and time again.
And they are hot.
But the revolver allows you to essentially keep your casings after the shot.
Right.
More difficult to reload. You're using every individual round to reload as opposed to just changing out a magazine on a semi-auto.
So cons on it would be that you're holding 5.
You're holding only 5.
And 5 might not be enough.
And it's a lot.
But
the time to reload is extended. That is considered a snub nose. That's a Ross E38 special right there.
Mm-hmm.
It's a shorter nose, so that's meant for personal carry.
Right.
It is a little thicker because of the cylinder, but it still is a very comfortable gun to carry if you're going to carry a revolver. For the sake of time, let's get to the river. My screen overlay. I hate that part of that. All right, so today on the river, let's talk about male versus female. We're going to be sexist on this program. We've seen some weapons there, but really it's more about style.
Right.
There is an active market in firearms to appeal to the female carrier.
They're
and it's not just handbags, right?
Right. No, they're pretty.
It's to design them to fit hands, to fit styles and colors. So go ahead and reach for that. I believe that's a Ruger LCP, Tiffany Green right there. This is real popular with the ladies. I got this from Posey.
Right.
This is not what my wife carries. But it is a 380 caliber, which is essentially a glorified 9mm.
Right.
But it 380. Oh, I need to do the switch. Sorry. A 380 there. It's a lot like what we saw in the sky, just a lot smaller.
Right.
Hold that both weapons up so it's people can see the size difference.
Very light.
Again, the sky's a 9mm. The one above that is a 380. The 380 is a 9mm, essentially the same grain, but packed smaller for the smaller carry. It is a personal carry manufactured round. And so you see how small that is compared to Mitch's hand. And so this is a really popular gun for ladies. I'll tell you what, go ahead and pick up the Kel-Tec at the very front, the Kel-Tec.
Okay.
There you go. This used to be the smallest firearm that you could get.
Right.
This is actually Producer Josh's gun.
And now...
Take note, government.
Now everyone
this is
knows.
Producer Josh's gun. It does not have a hammer, but it is not as small as the LCP. Go ahead and hold those two up next to each other. It's a single stack, so it's thinner, just like the LCP. But you can see that... That's obviously designed for male carry at the top.
Right.
Bottom's designed for female carry. But both of them are still smaller in stature than the Taurus that we showed that you carry, Mitch.
Right.
But smaller guns, both of them designed for personal carry, which is why they have composite stocks. It makes them lighter.
Yes.
Makes them lighter.
And this one does also. The Sky does also.
Yeah,
so,
Now, bring up the little bit.
The baby.
This is actually a specialty gun made by a little small company. It's called a Sherry. Now, the upside to this gun is hold it up to the LCP, the Tiffany green or blue or whatever they call it. You can see the gun size difference. See how much smaller it is than the smallest gun. Hold it up next to yours, Mitch, your firearm. So you can see if you want a little itty bitty gun. Now the downside to that is smaller guns are harder to hold in some cases.
It's very hard to hold.
So to offset,
my second finger doesn't even get on there.
It doesn't. But it's only a 22.
Oh well, there you go.
So we usually call these scare guns because the bang might scare somebody away.
Right.
But a 22 can still do a lot of damage. I'm not a snob to say. If I got shot with a 22, it'd be no big deal. No, it is a big deal when you get shot by a 22.
Right.
Now hold up our beast up there, the 44.
Oh, gracious.
Hold it up compared to the Sherry. That's a big old revolver, big round. That's a play gun for playing.
Here.
We do not recommend carrying Big Bertha there on your way out
this
the door.
It's so heavy.
It's so heavy. It's a big round. It's got a lot of recoil. The weight of the gun is actually the only thing to help you compensate for the recoil. I don't see any lady pulling that out of their purse. But you can see the diversity in guns
that we have on this
program.
The girl that pulls this out of her purse, she and I need to be friends. Because clearly, oh my stars.
I agree. So there's the big dog. Last but not least, I actually carry a Glock 27. It is on the form here if you want to hold it up right there across from the Sherry. That's my Glock 27. That is, as we go out today, running out of time, the Glock 27 is a great piece.
Mm-hmm.
I've always been a big fan of that because it's double stack. It fits great in my hand. It's reliable. It can get dirty. It doesn't rust. I carried a lot of guns over the years, and that tends to be one of my favorites. Is that Glock 27. It's a baby Glock. It's short. It's double stack. I love it. It's not the only one I carry. Occasionally, I'll carry the Rossi. That tends to be my hunt or out in the woods kind of gun.
Okay,
but that's
so wait,
all we've got
which
today.
Which one's Rachel's?
Rachel's. Oh, I forgot to show you. Rachel's. We got a little bit of time. Pull it up here. Walther P22.
Look at that.
Walther P22. And then we do have a Taurus Curve, if you'll hold that one up real quick. The Taurus Curve is actually a great one. Turn it sideways so they can see the curve as we run out of time here. But again, they've got all kinds of tricks. Go to Posies, go to VOW, tune in to Man Up America. Maybe we can do a follow-up episode. And that's all we have time for today, folks. I'm the good Dr. Jay Adam. That's Mitch over there. Listen to Talk 101.3 The Buzz, WTNB Television. We're out.
It's reassuring to know that when you retire, Woodman Life will be there with you, providing insurance protection and financial security so that you can sit back, relax, and enjoy your retirement, knowing that you and your family are safe and secure. For more information,
423-790-2847.
Woodman Life, standing strong for generations.